Oh, Gloria in excelsis Deo.
Oh. de accorda fidelium Sancti Spiritus illustratione docuisti, da nobis fine ode Spiritu recte sapere, et de eus semper consolatione gaudere. Per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum Filium Tuum, qui te convivit et regnat in unitate Deus et Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Es repente de cielo solus, tamquam advenienti spiritus vehementis, et repedi totam domum ubi erant sedentes, et apparu erunt illis dispetitiae lingue tamquam inis, seguique supra singulos eorum. Et repleti sunt omnes Spiritus Sancto, et ceperunt loqui variis linguis, pro Spiritus Sanctus dabate loqui minis. Erat autem, in Jerusalem habitantes Judaei, viri religiosi ex omninatione, quae succedo est. Facta altum her hoc voce convenit multitudo, et mente confusa est. Quoniam audiebat unus quisque lingua sua illos loquentes. Stupebant altum omnes et mirabante dicentes, non ecce omnes isti qui locuntur Galilei sunt. Et quam nos audivimus unus quisque linguam nostram, in qua natis humus. Parti et meri et elamite, et qui habitat Mesopotamiam, Judeam et Cappadociam, Pontum et Asiam, Phrygiam et Pamphyliam, Egyptum et partes Libiae, quae est circa Cyrene et Alphene Romani, Judei quoque et Proseni Tigretes et Arabes, audivimus eos, loquentes nostris linguis magnalia Dei.
Reading from the Acts of the Apostles. When the day of Pentecost had come, the disciples were all gathered together. Suddenly from the sky there was a noise like a strong driving wind that filled the whole house where they sat. There appeared to them tongues as a fire that parted and came to rest on each one of them. They were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other tongues and to proclaim according to the promptings of the Spirit. Now there were living in Jerusalem devout people, Jews of every nation under heaven, who on hearing the sound gathered in a crowd. But they were confused, because each one heard the speakers in his own language. This astonished them, and they asked in amazement, "Aren't these men who are speaking all Galileans? How is it then that each of us hears them in his own native language?" We are Parthians, Medes, and Elamites, inhabitants of Mesopotamia, of Judea and Cappadocia, of Pontus and Asia, of Phrygia and Pamphylia, of Egypt and the regions of Libya around Cyrene, even visitors from Rome, all Jews or Jewish converts, Cretans and Arabs too. And yet we hear them speaking in our own tongues about the great things which God has done. Continuation of the Holy Gospel according to John. At that time, Jesus said to his disciples, "If anyone loves me, he will keep my word. Then my Father will love him, and we shall come to him and make our dwelling place with him. Whoever does not love me does not keep my words. Yet the word that you hear is not my own, but comes from the Father who sent me. All this I have spoken to you during my stay with you. But the Paraclete, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you everything and remind you of all that I told you myself. Peace is my farewell to you. My peace is my gift to you, and I do not give it to you as the world gives it. Do not let your hearts be troubled or fearful. You have heard me say to you, I am going away and I am coming back to you. If you love me, you would rejoice to have me go to the Father, for the Father is greater than I. But I have told you this now even before it happens, so that when it does happen, you may believe. I shall no longer speak in language with you, for the peace of the world is, for the prince of the world is coming. Actually, he has no hold on me. But the world must recognize that I love the Father, and that I do exactly as the Father has commanded me." Thus are the words of the Holy Gospel. Our doors are now open to the public. The church is open daily for private prayer from 9 a.m. until 7 p.m. We will let you know as soon as we are permitted to have masses for the public. And the sacrament of confession is available at the usual hours on Sunday in our parish garden. Our parish relies on the generosity of our people, and your Sunday donation helps us continue our services at our parish and within our city. You can give online using our website or see the link in the video description. Thank you for your generosity and help during this time. Today's Mass is offered for the intention of deceased members of the Peters and Schultz family, as well as for deceased Stella and Henry Konopka and deceased Donald Shimchuk. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. The Feast of Weeks, also known as Pentecost, was the second of the three major festivals in the Jewish calendar. On Mount Sinai, God told the people through Moses, "Three times in the year you shall keep a feast to me. Three times in the year shall all your males appear before the Lord God." First, he told them that they must observe the Passover every year as a remembrance of their delivery. Then he told them, "You shall keep the feast of harvest, of the first fruits of your labor, of what you sow in the field." It marked the time when the first fruits of the wheat harvest were gathered and offered to the Lord. The Acts of the Apostles that we heard today relate to us that on the Jewish feast of Pentecost, 7 weeks after the passion, death, and resurrection of the Lord, there were devout Jews from every nation under heaven in Jerusalem for the festival. But celebrating the Pentecost of the New Covenant today, it doesn't occur to us that God purposely chose the day of this Jewish feast for the sending of his Holy Spirit. For he made the law that required Jewish men to come to the temple every year for this feast, so that they would be there on that very day. It was to be the birth of the church, and he wanted many people to be there for that great event. And we know from the Acts of the Apostles that about 3,000 were baptized that day alone. Had it not been for the crowds, this might have never happened. The feast of Pentecost in the Jewish calendar also commemorated the giving of the law of Moses on Mount Sinai. God gave Moses the old law for the benefit of his chosen people. But the new law, which replaced it on the day of the new Pentecost, was not to be just for Jews, but for all nations. The old law was given amidst thunder and lightning on Mount Sinai. The new law was announced with a rush of violent wind and tongues of fire. The new law was announced just as Moses came down from the mountain with the old law and proclaimed it to the Israelites. The apostles came down from the upper room with the new law and preached it to the crowds. The violent wind that filled the whole house was not a natural wind, but a supernatural force, which accompanied the descent of the Holy Spirit. Wind has always been an image of God and his action among us. When Nicodemus came to see Jesus in the night, Jesus told him, "The wind blows where it wills, and you hear the sound of it, but you do not know whence it comes or whither it goes. So it is with everyone who is born of the Spirit." Wind has always been a symbol of the Holy Spirit. And the Acts of the Apostles tell us that they saw what appeared to be fire separating out into tongues, and it settled on each one of them. Fire was a symbol of the power and presence of God, who spoke to Moses from the burning bush, and who descended onto Mount Sinai in fire to give the commandments to Moses. Fire in our natural world gives light and warmth. The fire of the Holy Spirit enlightened the minds of the apostles with the light of truth and set their hearts on fire. Because the account of Pentecost in the Acts of the Apostles says that the fire that descended upon those in the upper room descended on those in the upper room separated into tongues, perhaps God was showing the instrument through which the apostles would transform their newly infused knowledge into words. Wasn't it through their tongues that they spread the gospel? And then as the fire dispersed itself among those in the room, was it not an indication of how the apostles themselves were to disperse and preach to all nations? The sound of a strong wind drew crowds toward the upper room where the apostles were gathered, and the people were bewildered because each of them heard the apostles speaking in his own language. But this gift of tongues wasn't the speaking of tongues that charismatics talk about today. It wasn't the babbling of unintelligible sounds that some attribute to the Holy Spirit. At that first Pentecost, the apostles spoke the language they knew. Aramaic. Perhaps some even spoke Greek. But what the crowds heard wasn't Aramaic or Greek. Instead, each one understood them in his own language. People who had come to Jerusalem from all around the Roman Empire and from beyond. They were amazed because they knew that these men were all common Galileans. Yet all of them heard these men proclaiming God's mighty works in his own language. In this gift of tongues on Pentecost, the early fathers of the church saw an undoing of the Tower of Babel when, as we read in the book of Genesis. The Lord came down and was happy with what men were doing. So he confused the language of all the earth. But at Pentecost, all the peoples who had been scattered across the earth came back together in Jerusalem on that day when God was preparing to reunite them. Mankind had been divided by all its different languages, but when each heard the apostles speak about the kingdom of God in his own language, God that day restored the unity of mankind through the church to which he had given birth that day. And so, as history unfolds, we discover little by little how God has woven each of its threads together. What we think of as coincidences, things that just happen to fit together, are really pieces of God's plan that unfold before our eyes as each movement of a grand symphony. The motives which the divine composer introduced in the first movement appear again later, developed, refined, and brought to fruition. God planned for Pentecost long before it ever took place, even before the beginning of time. What we see as individual events have always been in the divine mind as one, eternal, and complete thought. St. Irenaeus wrote that the Spirit came down on the disciples at Pentecost after the Lord's ascension, with power to open the gates of life to all nations and to make known to them the new covenant. So it was that men of every language joined in singing one song of praise to God, and scattered tribes, restored to unity by the Spirit, were offered to the Father as the first fruits of all the nations. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And in the end,
Receptis salutaribus moniti, et divina institutione formati, audemus dicere. Pater noster, qui es in celis, sanctificetur nomen tuum, adveniat regnum tuum, fiat voluntas tua, sicur in cielo et in terra. Panem nostrum quotidianum da nobis hodie, et dimitte nobis debita nostra, sicur et nos dimitimus debitoribus nostris, et ne nos inducas in tentationem. Per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.
Pax Domini sit semper vobiscum.
Et cum spiritu tuo.
Oh.
vobis tuum.
Et cum spiritus tuum.
Oremus. Sancti Spiritus Domine, cor la nostra mundet infusio, et sui roris intima aspersione funde, per Dominum nostrum Iesum Christum Filium tuum, in unitate spius de Spiritus Sancti Deus, per omnia saecula saeculorum.
Amen.